The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hi, everybody. This is Mike from Hedgehog. We're going to get started in a little bit. Just let everyone else funnel in, and I'll be back to you in a couple minutes. All right, everybody. Figured that's enough time. So let's get started. We have a great presentation in store for you today. So I have a couple announcements, and then I'll kick it off. So first, future meetings. We don't have anyone scheduled for the next couple months. So if you or anyone you know is interested, you can shoot me an email, and I'd love to get some feedback. You know, even just shoot some emails about what you're interested in, and maybe I could go search them out and find a speaker for it. Secondly, the tweet chat, we have the hashtag SUVG for some questions, some feedback after the webinar, during the webinar, whenever. It worked pretty well last time, so I figured to try it again and see if it picks up some more. So that's my introduction. So let me introduce Andrew, and we'll get started. So Andrew is a solutions engineer over at Sitecore. He's going to come and speak to us today about PowerShell and how he feels about it, how he uses it, things like that. I've heard that's going to be a great presentation, so I'm excited, and that's about it. So Andrew, you ready? Make Andrew the presenter, and
yes, I'm ready.
We'll be good to go. All right, Andrew, you have control.
Okay. I'll show the monitor. Okay, can you see my screen now?
Yeah, we can see it loud and clear.
Okay, hi, everybody. My name's Andrew Chumachenko. Today, I'm going to share my experience with using some Microsoft PowerShell with Sitecore. So let's get started. The presentation is going to be split into three main parts. In the first part, I'm going to make a brief introduction of Microsoft PowerShell and also mention the most essential concepts which are used in existing solutions. The second part will be actually overview of existing solutions which utilize Microsoft PowerShell capabilities with Sitecore. And third part going to be overview of essentials for PowerShell integration into a .NET application. Let's start with a history overview for Microsoft PowerShell. Microsoft PowerShell started in November 2006 when the PowerShell 1.0 was released. In 2009, on July, the version 2.0 was released, which is current stable version. This version already has over 2 years of market experience, let's say so. So it's used over 2 years, so it's pretty stable. It has a good history. And recently, on December 2011, PowerShell 3.0 Community Technical Preview 2 was released by Microsoft. Currently, PowerShell 2.0 is an integral part of Windows 7 and Windows Server 2008 R2. It's also available as a standalone installation for Windows XP, Windows Server 2003, Windows Vista, and Windows Server 2008. So let's get started with main concepts of PowerShell. The main and the greatest difference of PowerShell from all other stuff that we know is that PowerShell actually operates on objects, whereas all other existing command line interpreters, they operate on strings. Let me demonstrate this with the following example. So let's consider we have a simple task. We need to obtain a process identifier of a running process by the process name. So in command line, in outboot command line, one might try to solve this task in the following way. So I would list task list application to find the list of running processes. I would filter output by the image name. I would specify format output to comma separated values, and I would say that I don't want to see a header. So here we receive the details about the process of interest, but I'm particularly interested in this part of string. And while preparing the presentation, I spent about 40 minutes trying to use only CMD capabilities to filter out this piece of information, but no luck there. So you cannot do this without using external programs which were created to process strings. Let's try to accomplish the same task in a PowerShell. We can use getProcess command to obtain list of all processes on the system, and we can filter its output right away by specifying the process name. We received pretty much the same output. This is text information specifying details about our running processes, but the thing here is behind the scenes PowerShell uses objects. So for example, if we use another command, getMember, which actually does some sort of reflection on objects, we can see that the result of the previous operation was actually an object of type system diagnostics process with all that methods, handy methods and properties we've got used to in .NET. So now I can use this specific object to figure out the piece of information I need right away, the process ID. And next we can try the approach of CMD in PowerShell just to compare these guys in action. So I can do the same. I will actually copy it. So I will perform the same command in CMD from CMD in PowerShell. I have obtained the same result, but again, if I do getMember, I see this is the system string object, so I can use .NET API to manipulate on this object. So let's do result equals, let's put this string into a variable and then split the variable by a comma separator, which gives us nice list. Then from this list we will take particularly only one entry, and on this entry we will replace the symbols we don't need, the quotes, with an empty values. So here we go, just with couple lines of coding of instructions in PowerShell, we managed to get the piece of information like in two different ways, and just much faster than we could do this with old command line interpreter. So let's move on. And the other useful thing about PowerShell is that the set of commands in PowerShell is very extendable. And here, the main building block of this extensibility for PowerShell is a commandlet class. Actually, it's based on internal command in the hierarchy of classes from Microsoft, and we can see that all existing commandlets actually derive from PowerShell commandlet class, which is in turn derived from commandlet class. And now we will talk a bit about commandlet design. Well, commandlets concept is tightly tied to pipelines in PowerShell. That's why it makes sense to review them together. Pipelines concept is common to almost all command line interpreters, and PowerShell uses pipelines of objects, whereas other command line interpreters used pipelines of strings, which is, again, main difference of PowerShell. It always operates on objects. You can think of a pipeline as a sequence of operations which are used to process input set of data, and every chunk of data, one by one, is passed through the pipeline, making it through every operation one by one. So let me illustrate it right away. We have our familiar get process command, commandlet, which, as we know, return a list of objects, where every object describes a specific process running on the computer. Now we can use pipeline to filter out the output of the get process commandlet, and we can filter, for example, by process name, SVC host. So what we received here is basically a list of objects, a list of processes, but this is not full list of processes running on the computer, but filtered out using the where object processor in the pipeline. This processor just makes decision whether a specific object will make further through the pipeline, or it will just start the next pipeline iteration. And just we'll add one more processor to the pipeline for each object, which just basically performs some operation on every object that is passing through the pipeline. And here we will just select ID property of every filtered project. So let's get back to the slide. The slide demonstrates essential methods of a commandlet class. So let's review them one by one. The begin processing method is used to provide one-time pre-processing functionality for the commandlet when the pipeline is just started. Process record method is used to provide record by record processing in the pipeline for every object that is passing through the pipeline. End processing is used to provide optional one-time post-processing functionality for the commandlet when the pipeline ends. And stop processing is used to perform necessary operations when the user stops the pipeline asynchronously, for example, by typing Ctrl C in a console window. The other building blocks of PowerShell commands family extensibility are functions, scripts, and modules. Functions concept is very familiar and very common. On this slide, there is illustrated a simplistic function declaration in PowerShell. Actually, PowerShell provides very comprehensive syntax for functions declaration, which simplifies processing of the function input parameters, allowed and even allows to define commandlet lifecycle code blocks like begin processing, process record, and then processing, which we just reviewed, in the function body. So you don't even need to create a .NET object to create your custom commandlet. You can just use the scripting language of PowerShell and do it right away. So let's move further to scripts. The scripts are just natural way to combine functions declarations or combine some instructions into a text file with .ps1 extension, which then can just be executed from PowerShell, or all function declaration from this file can be imported to the current PowerShell run space. And modules, this is just convenient way to distribute some PowerShell functionality. Modules, they are basically a set of self-sufficient commandlets or functions which can be just then distributed and reused by other developers. Next major concept is a concept of PowerShell providers. On the slide you can see output of get help command for PowerShell built-in documentation for providers. And Windows PowerShell providers are Microsoft .NET framework based programs that make the data in a specialized data store available in Windows PowerShell so that you can view and manage it. And the data that a provider exposes appears in a drive, and you accept the data in a path like you would on a hard disk drive. So basically, when you have your custom data provider, let's say just collection of data, then you create PowerShell data provider, and that data provider creates an abstraction of file system hierarchy over your data. So you can work with your data like you would operate on a file system on a computer. Providers concept is utilized in implementation of Sitecore Rocks PowerShell integrations, which we'll review next in a few slides. So here we have transferred to the next part of the presentation, which is overview of existing solutions. The first integration we're going to review is PowerShell integration with Sitecore Rocks Visual Studio extension. So you can obtain Sitecore Rocks extension using extension manager of Visual Studio. You can find it in online gallery just by searching for Sitecore Rocks. Here we go. So you can install it right away. We'll get that guy back. Had a few words left. Sitecore Rocks. Here is a more information link which leads to just a second, have some. Which leads to a site, to wiki site for the for Sitecore Rocks module, where you can find the references to useful articles to get started with the Visual Studio extension. So once you have Sitecore Rocks installed, you can start a Sitecore Explorer, which basically displays all existing connections to Sitecore instances. And you can start PowerShell integration for every specific database for a solution. For example, I will start it here for the master database. You just, from context menu, you choose Start PowerShell, and it brings up the PowerShell window where it initiates the Sitecore Rocks provider right now. The provider actually provides abstraction of Sitecore content tree as a computer drive, so you can think of items as of files, you can get content of items, you can copy items and I'll do all these basic operations. So let's see on the examples. So let's do get item for Sitecore content home. Here we have object get member. So we have an object with a properties for name, ID, owner, template ID set right on the object itself. We can also do get child item for Sitecore content home, which will bring us Sitecore content home, which will bring us the list of sub items. Then we can do it using recurse parameter, which will do it recursively. Also, you can use all the other capabilities of PowerShell, like pipelines. For example, we can do get child item for Sitecore content home, and we can filter out the list of items by template name. Sample item. Just a second. Okay. Also, Sitecore Rocks provides a list of commandlets to manage Sitecore system level operations. Those are commandlets like publish a C database, publish a C item, update a C linked database. Actually, we can obtain a full list of commandlets provided by PowerShell integration for Sitecore Rocks using the following approach. First, we need to change to the default provider, which is file system provider. Then let me just copy the command over here. Okay, so it was executed right away. So it, what it basically does, it uses get command, commandlet to return all the commandlets currently registered to the PowerShell run space. Then it filters the list, checking implementing type is not equal null, which means that the specific commandlet is implemented in an assembly, and then it just checks that the implementing type full name starts with Sitecore. So here we have all the list of commandlets provided with Sitecore PowerShell integration. And let me also show what happens behind the scenes when you communicate to a Sitecore instance using PowerShell integration. Let's get back to the Sitecore Rocks provider. I'm gonna do CD Rocks. Okay, and let's repeat any of the command. Let's say this one. As we can see, what actually happens is that Sitecore uses that PowerShell integration uses Sitecore service to send the data and obtain response from the server. So it actually sends credentials, it sends parameters of the operation, ID of the operation, and well, it actually retrieves a list of the items It actually retrieves all the response data from the response of the web service. Okay, so let's move on from here. And let's investigate the PowerShell provider implementation. Okay, first, we need to obtain the assembly of containing Sitecore Rocks implementation. We can do this from the PowerShell itself. I closed the PowerShell window, so I will start it again. Okay, so we can use get ps provider commandlet to obtain a list of all registered providers. We can filter it down to Sitecore Rocks. Now we can use the implementing type of Sitecore Rocks, which gives us Sitecore PowerShell data provider base. And now we're gonna get the assembly location, which says us where the assembly is stored. Now we're gonna copy the assembly to the local folder, sequential group merge. Now let's open the assembly. See virtual group merge Sitecore PowerShell. So here we have it. Rocks. Okay, so here we have Rocks provider, which is actually based on provider base class. And here we can see the provider base class, which is derived from navigation commandlet provider class of PowerShell. And this guy actually implements all the stuff that providers should be responsible of, like copy item, get child item, all the operation that we performed, which actually ends up sending a request to a Sitecore web service. Okay, so here we shifted to the other PowerShell integration experience, which is PowerShell console shared source module. The module is developed by Adam Najmanovich. The module is available for download in Sitecore shared source library. What it actually does, it instantiates and hosts PowerShell related infrastructure inside Sitecore CMS worker process. Unlike the previous solution, we just acted as a proxy, actually sending some data to web service and bringing back the results. This guy honestly hosts the PowerShell infrastructure inside our process. So let me show you the module itself. You can start the module. After you install the module package, you will have this entry in Sitecore Start menu, so you can just launch the window. It looks pretty much like a standard PowerShell window in Windows. The module comes with a set of predefined commandlets. Let's use the same approach we used before to obtain a list of all the commandlets which are provided with the module. So let me copy the command again. So again, we get list of all the commands. We filter them out to the guys implemented in an assembly, and we require the assembly name to start with cognified PowerShell. So we press Control Enter, we execute this command, and we obtain the list of all the commandlets provided with the module. You can see that there are a lot of commandlets related to analytics operation, commandlets related to basic operations, to simplify basic operations like obtain indexes, obtain databases, publish item. So very handy stuff you can do with just one instruction in PowerShell. You can also check in Adam's blog. Let me bring it up. On his blog, Adam describes and provides snippets for various examples of integration with PowerShell, including creating extensions to Sitecore desktop interface, which will in turn start executing some PowerShell scripts stored in specific field of an item. So lots of interesting stuff to read here. So I will move on from here. The next experience, the next integration is a PowerShell terminal module. This is much work in progress module. It uses the same approach as the PowerShell console and the previous module. The only difference is that this module doesn't require installation, so it was developed with the concept of with the concept to be used as a debugger utility. So its installation doesn't require installation of any assemblies, and therefore it doesn't require restart of the current working process. So let me show you the module itself. Currently the module is available as a separate page deployed to the Sitecore instance. Well, actually it brings up just a terminal window just to provide this shell experience. So let's try to perform some stuff here. My first example will show you how we can access the internals of Sitecore using the PowerShell integration. So let me start a publishing operation here. I think actually I will start with copying the comment. Sitecore jobs job manager. So this is how you can invoke a static method of a class in PowerShell, jobs. So now we can see that there are no jobs running in this Sitecore instance. Let's start publishing here. Okay, we can see a couple of jobs running here. And let's enhance the output using the pipeline. So for each entry in the jobs, we're gonna output separator, we're gonna output job name, we're gonna output job status. Here we go. So we can see that there are, let me count the job, there are 9 jobs running at the moment, and these jobs are, let's check what is going on here, updating index on databases, database agent is running, publish is running, and actually by refreshing the jobs list, we will see the updated status of the jobs running. So it will show, so currently the publishing job shows us how many items were processed during the publishing, and while the publishing was going, we were able to monitor how much items are published. So it illustrates how you can use the PowerShell integration to actually get an internals of running Sitecore process without restarting it, just like attaching to it, which is really handy and is really cool. So let's illustrate a few more examples of using Sitecore API. First, I'm going to get a reference to Sitecore master database, Sitecore configuration factory get database master. Now I'm going to select some items. Sitecore content and all its descendants. Here we have the list. And now we can use the pipelines to process it a bit. So let's filter it by template name, which is going to be equal to sample item. Yep, have the list here. And let's output just URI of the item. We will output just URI string representation. So here we have list of our content items filtered by specific template and just list of Sitecore links to every item. One more thing. Sorry, we'll just get back to the slide. One more thing that I was investigated was obtaining more internal information on threads running inside the Sitecore. Well, actually, you can obtain information on the process using capabilities of system diagnostics, namespace, diagnostics, process. You can do get current process, which will obtain some data, information on the process. You can do the threads, which will show you the list of running threads on the process. You can do measure from here. Another useful commandlet, which just show you statistics, which says that we have 66 threads currently running in the application. I was trying to obtain stack trace of every process. If I managed to do that, that would be just awesome. But after investigating this a little bit, it turned out that you cannot obtain a stack trace of a process thread object, which the guys returned by the threads property, but you need to have the reference to the system threading.thread object itself, which I don't yet have. Okay. The next thing, I'd like to use the module to demonstrate possible approach to command line user interface implementation. For terminal emulation of the module, the jQuery terminal JavaScript library is used. So you can see it here, terminal jcubic.pl. It's very useful script. So let me bring up the Visual Studio and show. Let's see, I think I should have it in recent projects. This terminal. So it actually does all the rendering of the terminal and handles all the operations in the terminal by itself, so you don't need to implement anything, but it handlers for the default event, which is when a user presses enter button on keyboard. So let me show you the structure of the page. The page contains two update panels, one for which handles input events from a user, and the other which are responsible for requesting updates from the server once the comment was sent for execution. And what do you need? So this is the only effort which is required to have this terminal emulation is declaration of this div element. Then you need to set up the jQuery terminal module to handle the event, to the enter key press event, which just copies some values to proper ASP.NET hidden fields and just trigger the update event for update panel. So once we have sent request for execution to the server, the output update panel is activated, which then just constantly asks the server for next portion of update until it receives the signal that the output ends. Then, well, actually, it's deactivated. Okay, I think that's pretty much about this integration here. Yeah, so this is PS terminal. Let's move on to the integration with .NET section. The picture on the slides contains information from an MSDN article which describes basic principle essentials of Windows PowerShell architecture. So let's review just the most essential information of the article. Everything starts after a hosting application hosts the PowerShell host object and PowerShell runtime inside of it. It happens in this example, the main function means the function which actually performs the hosting of the PowerShell infrastructure inside the application. In ASP.NET application, it can be any appropriate event handler or other method, for example. And from here, the method instantiates the instance of PowerShell host object inside the application. And as reference, I'd like to show you the implementation of PowerShell console module by Adam. So we're gonna search for scripting host. Scripting host is a custom implementation of PowerShell host object of Adam. It overrides some default PowerShell host behavior, and it also provides a custom scripting host user interface. This is a standard extension interface for the PowerShell host. It's displayed here on the diagram, which provides communication between PowerShell run space and PowerShell host. PowerShell host user interface and raw user interface, these are interfaces which are used to process the user interface events which happens in the PowerShell run space, like outputting some data to a console window, like writing some writing a string of information, writing an error to the console, writing a warning to the console, and so on. After a PowerShell host is instantiated, then the PowerShell run space should also be instantiated inside the application. The PowerShell run space is in fact the PowerShell runtime. It's normally used to process user commands synchronously and delivers results of processing to the hosting application, which then renders the result to the user. Let me illustrate this here. In the module, a script session class is introduced, which actually on its instantiation, script session constructor here, which on its instantiation actually creates a scripting host, create a run space using run space factory, create run space from the host and previously created configuration, and actually this create the PowerShell infrastructure inside the host application, which allows you to interact with it and access the process internals and all the and all other cool and interesting stuff. A few more things that I'd like to add here. So this was it was my experience with investigations related to PowerShell and its integration with Sitecore. We have further directions of investigations which include adding support for PowerShell scripts, which means that it would be useful to have a library of scripts stored together with the module on this file system, which then can be used to extend the run space with our custom commandlets with wrappers for frequently used operations. Also, we're investigating how PowerShell can be used to manage Sitecore instances in a cluster on scaled Sitecore installation, so that you can, from a single computer, you should be able to communicate to other servers in a cluster, send them commands, clearing caches on specific events, doing this on regular basis. So lots of automation that is the essential of Sitecore PowerShell. And which is also interesting, this is investigation of PowerShell capabilities for advanced Sitecore troubleshooting. As I previously showed in this session, the PowerShell is extremely precise tool to investigate the internals of the application, internal status of internal objects, internal data, and you can create custom event handlers. It's just lots of stuff to investigate there. Well, it was pretty much all the information I wanted to share during this meeting. I'd like also share a few bits of information afterwards, which are the tools I use to work with PowerShell. The main tool is Power GUI Script Editor, which is Visual Studio-like script editor, which makes the editing of PowerShell very, very productive. And one more utility, which is very interesting, it was suggested to me by Alex Shiba, is Microsoft Script Explorer for PowerShell. It's pre-release version, but it's like a single application which allows you to search information for PowerShell in different Microsoft-related sources, which is really cool, and it brings up lots of interesting stuff. And also list of references which were used in the presentation. Okay, so I think this is all the information I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much for your attention.
That was a great presentation, Andrew. So it looks like we have a couple questions here. One of the questions said, in your opinion, with each of these PowerShells, which one is best applied and where? The different PowerShell modules.
Yes. Which is the best applied and where? These guys are pretty different. Sitecore Rocks integration I would say you can do this integration for your development with Sitecore. If you need to, for example, automate creation of specific item structure, for example, for solution testing, it can be an example. Then I think Sitecore Rocks integration would do the trick pretty well. You can save item tree to an XML file and then just use this XML file to restore the items tree right away. The last one, the PowerShell terminal, this is work in progress, so it's not available yet. This is just a very early version of the module. Then the PowerShell console, let me switch to this guy. This is available as shared source installation. I think it can be used to create custom commandlets, so it can be used to perform management operation from the Sitecore desktop on the Sitecore content tree to perform some system level operations like publishing and something like that. So to make it short, Sitecore Rocks integration is good when you work with Visual Studio and you need to automate some content tree operations, and PowerShell console is good for managing Sitecore instance using the Sitecore desktop interface to perform some operations which might otherwise require a lot of UI clicking.
Great. I have another question here. Is Sitecore going to make a place that the community can share scripts, shared like a shared source script, maybe?
That's very, very cool idea. It's a really good question. So I think once we have mature vision of how PowerShell is going to work, what's going to be the architecture of PowerShell integration to Sitecore, then we definitely will think of a single storage where we can share the PowerShell scripts.
Okay, great. I think that's all the questions we have for today. Go over here again. Now, I'd like to say we need your help for future speakers. So if you have any ideas, send them over. I'd like to thank everyone for attending. I'd like to thank Andrew for a great presentation. That was really knowledgeable, and we've been getting tons of good feedback. Very impressive. And finally, there will be a copy of the of this presentation up on our website and on YouTube by Friday. So if you follow us on Facebook or any other place, you'll see an update of the presentation. And thank everyone for coming, and we look forward to see you next month. Bye, everybody.
Thanks very much. Bye.